Okay, I think we can restart. I want to continue with another bunch of slides, and then I'm going to use the blackboard. The next two or three slides show a little bit of design principles, and I call these strategies for realizing lightweight structures. And you can see what I told you before, here is a more or less concrete design element for an aeroplane. Here you have the skin, and you have this kind of stiffness, the longitudinal stiffness, and here the circumferential ones. And this is what it looks like here when the whole thing is going to be assembled. So you know, you have seen an aeroplane in production. It is really an awfully complex thing, just the pure metal part. But then come all the installations, the hundreds of kilometers of cables and the electronics, and you may really wonder why you don't have more failures. Okay, and if you have an interesting development, in the automotive industry, we are trying to replace steel with aluminums, but aluminum is more costly. If you want to gain something, you have to pay for it. That's what I keep telling my students. If you want to have to get something, you have to give something back. And there's only one thing in life that is free, and that's your mother's love. Everything else has to be paid for, including your father's love. But in the aerospace industry, people are making the next step. They try to replace aluminum with carbon-reinforced plastics, polymers, and which is a huge leap forward. But you may have read the newspapers about the problems that Boeing have, and this was predictable. This was a predictable disaster. So management, going to be taped, right? Some kinds of management are among the most stupid people on earth. Incompetent. See how the General Motors management has run down a company that was the world leading company in automotive industry, that was an American icon, you know. General Motors was kind of identical to America, and now it went bankrupt. And all these stupid guys left and got the millions of dollars pushed up their asses. I mean, it is unbelievable, unbelievable. Cancel that. And the Boeing disaster was predictable because they outsourced many of the most important strategic parts to companies around the world who had no experience either with fabricating these parts. So the disaster is there. And unfortunately, Airbus has to go the same way. They had the original design for the 250, the new Airbus 250 was ready. The design was done in metal, but then the customer said, Boeing is more modern than you are, please convert to plastics. I don't understand this, but people don't ask me, fortunately. So this is a close-up of a scapular stiffness, and here we see a nice crack, which we are going to talk about later. And unfortunately, all these parts are not welded, they are riveted. And you will see later, Wednesday afternoon, when you have enough time, we did an analysis, a careful analysis of an Airbus shell, and then you will see that they have, I think, six or seven different parts, a skin, this stiffener, a clip, a plus, and. So it's, from the design, from the production point of view, just awful. And from the design point of view, from the fatigue point of view, as awful, because it's there where the fatigue cracks happen. And why don't we weld aeroplanes? This would be much more elegant. And any idea why we don't rally aeroplanes? This is mass production technology and question. Why don't we rally aeroplanes? People have made interesting estimates. If we were able to weld aeroplanes, this would be an exception of my rule. If you want to have to get something, you have to pay for it. People would, for completely welded fuselage, a weight gain of between 20-25%, which is almost unbelievable. You know, people are happy with 2 or 3%. And a gain in production costs the same order of magnitude. But why don't they weld? You are engineers. Here we're dealing with high-strength aluminum alloys. These aluminum alloys are age-hardened. And when you weld, you heat the material and you destroy the hardening microstructure. That's it. But now they are trying to, you know, the Russians have developed new aluminum alloys and using design tricks you can also tackle the problem. And also the friction stir welding that I mentioned earlier on is a technology that does not reduce the strength as much as fusion welding does. So, yeah. Okay. Yes, this is the shell I was just mentioning. This is, they didn't tell us, but I guess it is a test shell for the original Airbus 250 design, which unfortunately will not be produced. And against my own rules, I'm giving the lights on. Here you see the longitudinal stiffness and the circumferential ones, and I guess you can't see it. Here's a clip here. You will see later drawings, and we had a crack here, what they call a two bay crack. This is a bay, one bay, and this is two bays, and the rules say that a fuselage has to be able to withstand a crack of the size of two bays without being disintegrated under operating conditions. Okay, because at cruising altitude you have a cabin pressure which is higher than the pressure of the environment. And a test was done at IMA in Dresden, and we did very interesting analysis. By the way, this is more than 2 by 4 meters here. And now back to the bay. And this is another method. This is just a different material, laminated structures. And this is the technology that is now being used for some high-tech auto builds and airplanes. And now, once again, like I said earlier on, we need the highest possible exploitation of the mass without compromising safety. This is important, the second part of the sentence. Second part of the requirement, without compromising safety. And this is the domain of numerical modeling using fracture and damage mechanics. Also, we can combine materials with different thicknesses. This is what they call, as a buzzword or a keyword in automobile industry, tailored blanks. So they weld thicker steels together with thinner steels to have the thicker material at locations of higher stresses and the thinner material at locations with lower stresses. So this is kind of a smart design principle. And the welding process is, you know, is something that has to be improved, and or you can combine different materials. But when you have different materials, different metals joined, We may have electrochemical reactions. This can be dangerous, but there are methods to prevent corrosion. Or we have built-in crack stoppers, and people also try, if damage really ever occurs during operation, it should be confined locally by appropriate design principles. Stiffeners, for example, are very nice crack stoppers. Stiffeners and other more new designs invented by Alcoa, the aluminum company in the US. And by the way, I visited them a few years ago. They have a huge R&D center in Pittsburgh. And they are struggling hard because they want to sell aluminum. They don't like the plastic airplanes. And so they are becoming creative with new design principles, very interesting design principles. And in the end, the competition is very, very, both kinds of design are very close to each other now, including weight savings. So a crisis makes you always creative. But we always only learn from crises. Only.
Okay.
A warning. When we go to higher strength materials, this can be disastrous. Because when we increase the strength, we are faced with negative effects. Everybody knows who has ever dealt a little bit with fatigue that the endurance limit scales with the strength. The endurance limit of steels is about 50% of yield, and of aluminum alloys, some 30, 35% or 40%, whatever. But this is only true for smooth and polished specimens. But you may have seen very few components that are smooth and polished. They have transitions in diameter, in thickness, they have notches on them. Any kind of stress raises or rivet holes in the aircraft structures. And we suffer from an increasing notch sensitivity, and also fracture toughness decreases. Once again, if you want to get something, you have to pay for it. Higher strength is usually comes along with lower ductility and toughness, and also for parts with or components with stress raises, we have lower fatigue and strength. Now, this is a key misunderstanding. Fatigue crack propagation rate does not vary with strength. Sometimes, when you increase strength, sometimes the fatigue crack propagation rate, as we will see later in the fatigue chapter, the rate decreases or it increases or it stays constant, so there's no systematic trend with strength. I'm showing a diagram in a moment. And the critical crack size decreases because fracture toughness decreases. And we will see more details later. And the residual life decreases by a power with 2 to 4, not a power of 2 to 4, not a factor, a power of 2 to 4, due to fatigue crack propagation rate. And here's a diagram. This is a kind of high strength steel, which is very popular in the US. And here you see the RPE 0.2, 900 up to almost 1600 megapascals. And I plotted all the data points. I did that years ago when I had enough time, when bureaucracy was much less than it's nowadays. By the way, bureaucracy is a cancer for any kind of society, and it will kill us. Here you see the data points. You don't gain anything. And here you see the lower toughness materials leave the common band because fracture occurs here. another example, which is more striking. I collected steels from 250 to 660 megapascals, two totally different steels, and I plotted all the data points, and this is the scatter band that I ended up with. So where is the effect? And a few years ago, you may or may not know, we had some problems with high-strength steels, so the axles broke. There was one high-speed train that derailed, fortunately, at a very low speed. The axle had broken, and we did an analysis. We computed the fatigue propagation rate. And at that time, I visited somebody from the railway industry in Germany. And at the time of my visit, the lady received a call from the manufacturer of the bogie. So, you know what the bogie is? That's the frame underneath a locomotive or a car containing the two axles, and the bogie gives the car more flexibility on the track. And the first idea was making the axles thicker in order to reduce the stress, which is okay. But in that example, this would have meant a totally new design for the bogie frames. And when you imagine that the cost of the bogies cost about as much as the locomotive up there, then you would have lost 50% was new trains, 50% of the value of the trains. So this didn't work. Let's use high-strength steels. I heard that, you know, and I screamed loudly. Obviously, many designers, many engineers don't know some basic facts of fatigue. This is one of the basic facts. I teach my students in the course all these things here, and I keep telling them, whenever you are making this mistake, you have to go to jail. Now, you're dealing with fracture mechanics. When you go to industry and say, we have to do a fracture mechanics analysis, or we have to test fracture mechanics properties, people ask, why fracture mechanics? Almost nobody understands it at the management level, and it is additional costs. And where is the profit? There is no profit. Maybe afterwards, because you may avoid failures. Back on the multi-purpose way. And I have a number of historic failure cases that I think I should show you, because it is, again, it's the disasters from which we learn. And, another list here. Of course, fracture mechanics is now really indispensable. We even have it in standards and codes. We have to clarify failure cases. We have to find out who is guilty, who is going to pay, who has to go to jail. In the end, this may happen if fatalities occur, you know. You have to go to court. And of course, we have to prevent damage. We have to prevent human lives. The environment, remember the freight train that derailed in this country a number of months ago. Can be invested, of course. And once again, we want to realize lightning structures as well, failure probability. And the damage to economy is estimated at about 4% of the gross national product. 4% sounds low, but the absolute figure, imagine the gross national product of your country, and I don't know how many hundred billions it is, so it is really a substantial amount of money, plus the same amount due to corrosion, environmental effects. So it is really an economical impact. And not to forget, failure's damage the image, CBT, not just the present case. You may or may not remember that years ago in Alaska, BP had a pipeline that broke and spilled a lot of oil, and they had a problem then too. But now the disaster is much bigger, and I hope that the relevant people are punished. Not just by money, you have to go to jail. Okay, one of the most famous failures is the Titanic, the luxury liner, and I attended a lecture of one of the people who did the failure investigation. You may know that a few years ago a deep diver brought some material from the ship hull, and the material was tested, and it was an awful material, extremely low toughness. The temperature was low, of course, and extremely low toughness. And but the problem, the designers said the ship is unsinkable, and they were right. Unsinkable in case of one of the sections of the hull would be flooded, the ship would still have been afloat. But obviously, what people try to reconstruct from the survivors, you know, who made their stories, obviously the iceberg created a relatively small crack. But due to the low brittleness of the material, the crack jumped further and further and further until the crack was too long. It was extremely low or lousy brittleness of the material. Not the design, it was the material. Okay, the Liberty ships, the prominent example, several ships broke when they were sitting in the harbor without being loaded, just in the winter time, the material was too brittle. The Comet is not so popular nowadays. The Comet was the first jet passenger plane not built in the US but the United Kingdom by de Havilland. And they lost two planes in cruising altitude. And the reason was fatigue, cracks that were not discovered. The Polaris rocket was a military rocket, and it had a brittle fracture of the combustion chamber. And this initiated, you know, for military, indefinite amounts of money are available. And this initiated fracture mechanics standardization, ASTM. The committee E24 was formed, and they created the very first fracture mechanics test standard, E399, which is still in existence with modifications, of course. And the Lusaka crash was, again, a Boeing plane which crashed with fatigue. It was the tail of the balancers, one of the balancers broke, and the plane went nose down to the ground. American Air Force fighter, the V, one of the wings broke off, which is a nightmare for any pilot. And the Alexander Kielan platform, Norwegian platform, failed in the 80s by fatigue. It capsized. So dozens of people were killed. It was a small fatigue. Aloha Airline, everybody knows that. And the ice train crash, I have a few pictures. So this has nothing to do with lightweight structures, but it's a funny picture. And it's also an interesting example. In the early days of railroading, there were many accidents due to bad material and lack of design rules. And people didn't know about fatigue. Axles broke, wheels broke, rails broke, and the problem at that time was whenever there was an accident, the carriages, the passenger cars, were made of an underframe, wooden, later steel, and the hull was just a wooden hut. just placed on the film underframe, and any accident had washed away, you know, the huts, and so many people were killed at that time, many more than nowadays, in particular in the US. This is more for fun here. The picture has nothing to do with failure. Obviously, the engineer didn't use his brakes early enough, or the brakes failed. The picture is always very nice. And this was a very sad accident. It happened 12 years ago near where I live, and the cause of this accident was a chain of unlikely events. A chain of unlikely events. Every event was unlikely to happen, but they happened in a row, you know. And the ice train is made of aluminum, and unfortunately the aluminum suffers from vibrations. So people decided to replace the solid steel wheels by wheels containing a rubber ring, as all trams and metro cars have. And then there is a steel flange on top of it. It can't be seen here. My original picture is much better. It is the beamer here. I blame the beamer. And unfortunately, a crack developed inside that wooden frame, a steel flange. And they did inspections, ultrasonic inspections, but at the surface of the wheels. So they didn't discover the crack. The crack became critical, and the conductor made a note that a car made heavy noises for a number of days, but this warning was ignored. Second event. Then on that special trip, the train was running at 200 kilometers, and the flange finally broke. It was trained, and the train did not derail, because trains with bogies are quite stable. And then came a station with a turnout, or switch, or point, whatever word you may prefer, and this a flange was sitting firmly in the bogie frame, and this turned the turnout, and all the following cars turned, left the original track, they derailed, and just behind that was a concrete bridge. And concrete is not, you know, horizontal forces, it's absolutely impossible, the concrete collapses. And so many of the cars were buried under the bridge here. You see the damage here. And I've seen also a reconstruction, a video of the reconstruction. And 101 people died within a few seconds. This was very bad. Yeah, this initiated a lot of safety work in Germany, I think, also in other places. And this is a well-known picture, everybody knows that. Again, please, here I'm not talking, you're not, during these few minutes, I'm not learning about fracture mechanics, but about the necessity of being careful, of setting up safety measures. Here, this was avoidable. This was an early 737, Boeing 737, and the panels were bonded and riveted. And Boeing realized that after some service, the bonding lost its strength. So all the stresses were transferred via the rivets. They were overloaded and cracks occurred. And Boeing, the manufacturer, circulated a sign of warning, and with a specific legal stage that says that the companies, the operators, are not obliged to take any measures, but they are recommended to. And profit, of course, is more important than human lives, as you know. And the problem was known, and believe it or not, this was in Hawaii, and those areas have always nice weather, so there is an open stair where people enter the area of the plane via an open stairs, and a young couple was among them, and the girl said to her friend, "Look, there is a crack beside the door." Is that girls and technology? And not even the pilot. Pilot is obliged before any flight at least to walk once around his plane and have a close look. Okay. Now, fundamentals of fracture mechanics. The contents of my talk. A little bit of fracture mechanics concepts, like listed here, and I'm running more on stable frame extension, including the heat cut propagation. And I think this is the moment when I switch to the blackboard. And is here anybody who has never ever had any contact with fracture mechanics? So you're all familiar with basics of fracture mechanics, right? Okay? Okay, così, come sa. And, così. And I'm rushing through some fundamentals on the blackboard. And if you have any questions, please feel free to interrupt me, to ask me. Don't hesitate, don't be shy. We are a small group. And it doesn't make sense if there is anything that you don't understand or don't believe, and that I'm carrying on. Okay? So, are you? Yeah, thank you.
Which has a distance r from the origin
and the radius includes an angle theta, the x-axis, polar coordinates give us simpler equations. We could also use Cartesian coordinates, but the polar coordinates are simpler. And this element is loaded by the stress components. I'm not writing them here on the blackboard. It is normal stresses in x direction, in y direction, in z direction. And also we have a shear stress, tau xy. And all these stresses, sigma ij, are a function of the applied stress times the square root of A of half the crack size divided by the square root of R times the function of the angle theta. So it's a very simple equation, and sometimes it's really interesting that problems that look complex or complicated can be described with simple analytical expressions. And now this product here, sigma times square root A, is combined to form the linear elastic stress intensity factor K. Because what we see here, the local stresses depend, of course, on the coordinates of the point we look at, of course, and also on this parameter, which is a kind of a constant, and which gives the intensity or the magnitude of the local stresses in this field here. So this is what we call a field parameter, and the local stresses, I'm just plotting here the stresses that open the crack. Here is the crack tip once again, and here we have the x-axis, and here is the sigma yy to make it simple. And for this case here, sigma yy is given by k over square root x. Because there is a pi here at the theta function, and this is usually pulled forward under the square root sign here. And so we have a very simple like this here, and for a given value of k, and if you increase either the applied load or the crack size, then k increases, and so will the local stress. So we receive a family of similar curves with k as a parameter. This is why we see the name that was given to k, stress intensity factor, because it gives the intensity or the magnitude of the local stresses. I'll be happy with the result. One of the basic goals in life is approaching happiness. Are you happy with the result? Is it realistic? You see, one of the basic is, I didn't tell you about the assumptions. Every model that we make up, any physical model, has to be based on assumptions, because we are never able to describe a physical condition or process in an exact manner. We are always making models. Like the map of Italy does not represent Italy, it is a model of Italy, and so on and so forth. A technical drawing of a table or a desk is not the table or the desk or the building or whatever it represents. It's a model for that. And every model has to be based on simplifying assumptions. Okay? When you think of the original Newton equations that were used for planets of the solar system, they were very nice, but again, the assumptions were simplifying the problem. And one of the assumptions was the crack has to be infinitely sharp. It's a mathematical cut, so there's no radius, which is the cause why we have infinitely high stresses. You see, the equation predicts infinity. There should be an x, and x here r is, or x here theta equal to zero. And so here the stresses tend to go to infinity. So we have a singularity here. Like the Big Bang. The Big Bang was also supposed to be a singularity, and now we have a new book telling me that it was not the case. And, are we happy? Do we have infinitely high stresses? This would mean that under infinitely low loads, fracture would occur, which hasn't happened. So it is nonsense. Okay? It is nonsense. Now when we go far away from the crack here, far away, as you see here, the stresses go down to zero. Does this make us happy? Imagine, what stress will we find when we go far away here? Are the stresses zero here? Oh, please. Are the stresses zero? Yeah? No. How high are they?
Zero.
Exactly. When you go far away from the disturbance here, you see the usual stress here, which is homogeneously distributed. This is a disturbance that is only local. So what you can say is that these equations, I can't give you the proof, but many experiments and fundamental analyses show that these equations are okay in the neighborhood of the crack, excluding the crack tip itself. And we have a radius. We have a radius around the crack tip. Here's the crack tip. Again, x and y. We have a radius at gives us the limit of the K field, and I define here the radius R subscript capital K, referring to the stress intensity factor, and this is roughly, you see, this stress here should approach sigma somewhere. So this is sigma. And it means that at some point here the local stress goes below sigma, and it is a matter of how much of an error I'm willing to accept. 1%, 5%, 10%. So this is why here I'm saying RK is about a tenth of the crack size. I hope you can read this color here. It's probably... Yeah, not so good. But we have front seats here. They are not more expensive than the back seats. You don't believe me? It's your own fault. When you can't read it, it's your own fault. No excuse. Okay, so now we have an idea about the field in which the linear elastic, we are talking about the linear elastic material, glass or high strength steel or whatever, within which the stresses can be described by the equations out of which I'm not writing here. They can be found in any textbook. And now going to practical application of the concept. Usually our engineering components cannot describe by an infinitely wide sheet. In many cases it's really possible. Think of a pipeline, you know, or a cylindrical pressure vessel, a long vessel with a short crack, so the length is kind of infinite as compared to the crack size, but in most cases it's impossible. Now, in reality, we have more complex components. So in real components, K depends on three kinds of geometry. The geometry of the component, then on the geometry of loading. Give you two examples. For example, tension versus bending, as an example, a pair of examples, and the geometry of the crack. What does that mean? I have drawings of all these things in my script for my students. I'm just giving you an example for the geometry of the crack. Usually, when we deal with fracture mechanics here, we may have a thin sheet. And so I'm drawing a section through the sheet. And usually, we believe that we have a through crack, the size of which, or the length of which is 2a. So this is a clear-cut example, and the usual theory is here. This is a simple case, and all of our specimens are made such that we have such a through crack. But frequently we have something else, particularly around the joint. We may have a crack that emerges from the surface. So this has a geometry that is different from this one, that is, should be obvious that the stress intensity factor here has a different value as compared to this one. And in this case, people define the crack size A by its depth. Don't ask me why. I wouldn't have done it, but this is history, and you have to take it as it is. Now, the simplest case of geometry, would like to start with that geometry here. We have a sheet or a plate of finite width. The width is 2W. And the crack size in the middle here is 2A. This also represents one of the specimen types we use in testing. And here, in this case, the stress intensity factor, K, and if you look at all these variabilities here, we have an infinite amount of, practically infinite amount of combinations of all these geometries. So we would have to calculate or express the stress intensity factor for an infinite amount of cases. And humans are lazy, as we know. The point is, the more we make our work easier, the more we have to pay for it. People get stressed. Okay. But a relatively intelligent solution was found, namely the original concept sigma times square root I A was rescued. So this is the solution for the infinitely wide case. And everything that deviates from that finite width, bending, surface crack, whatever, is captured within a dimensionless function. I call it capital Y. And this is a function of A over W, not of the absolute crack size, but of the relative crack size. And by normalizing, this is normalization, by normalizing, we make life again easier. And so, for example, for this thing here, when we look at different absolute sizes, we have the same function here. And this function, well, these functions have been developed for many, many cases, and they can be found in handbooks, thick handbooks with thousands of solutions. Or if it ever happens that you can't find a solution for your specific case, we have a finite element codes that run on a simple PC or even a laptop, and you can easily calculate your stress intensity factor. But for most cases, this is not necessary. Okay. So now, fortunately enough, our engineering materials, in particular metals. My personal experience is only with metals, not with plastics and not with porcelain, sorry, ceramics. And fortunately, these metals deform plastically. So in the case of failure, they can absorb a lot of energy. So this is a positive point of, you can't make a delicate design, for example, an automobile of glass or a brittle plastic. This would never work. So in case of an accident, a lot of energy should be absorbed, and in order to protect the travelers, in this case. Okay. And have you done a tensile test? Sigma versus epsilon, and we have you see a diagram like this one here, and here we have RP0.2, and it is this amount of plasticity here that helps absorbing energy in case of a failure. Now, let's go back to this center cracked panel or middle cracked panel. Once again, we have the crack. And when we apply a load, F force, then we will very early unloading, very early see here areas where plastic deformation happens. This can be observed initially when we have polished the surface of the specimen. Then you see traces, dark traces of plastic deformation and the dislocations leave the material. And when it's polished and you look at it with a low magnifying microscope, times 50 is enough. Then you see beautifully the traces of plastic deformation, the slip lines that come out of the material. And so you can even measure it, what I did also in my PhD, and you will receive a plastically deformed zone. And once again, I'm sorry, you probably can't see it, but my blackboard is not wide enough. So this size here is what I call omega, the size of the plastic zone. And the interesting thing is that there is a formula which is a very simple one, a very simple formula for the plastic zone. We can calculate the plastic zone under the conditions of linear elastic fracture mechanics by omega equal to the second power of the stress intensity factor divided by log pi and RP 0.2 second power. Once again, a very simple formula, but this is only for plane stress. I skipped the plane strain, which is not so important here. Yeah, plane strain is much smaller. And so a very simple thing for you to memorize. And sometimes I call my students at midnight at home and wake them up. What is the formula for stress intensity for stress intensity factor for the plastic zone size? That's what it does. I mean, these are the things the students have to memorize. You know, I don't want to see formulas in an exam. It doesn't make sense. But the simple, the basic things, you know, basic things should be present. Okay. So. But now, when we load further, a few words about the stress intensity factor here. It sounds a bit strange that we describe plastic deformation with a quantity named the stress intensity factor, which is valid for linear elastic behavior. Can that be true? Yes, it can. Because we are not describing, sorry for my finger, I need this for concentration. It looks even worse. Light's gone. We are not describing what's happening inside the plastic zone. This would be impossible with this concept. And what we describe is the extension. So where the elastic stress field is wiped away, but the elastic stress field is still valid. So it's just the border. And what happens inside is at this moment a dark hole, black hole. So but I think this is a general principle. You can apply this principle to any case in physics, in sociology, or whatever. And you may have I don't know whether it's really true, but you have a big city with a relatively homogeneous population, and you can describe the behavior of the population by set of equations or phrases or whatever, and you have a small ghetto type, you know, and unfortunately this happens, unfortunately, this is very inhumane, but it happens. You can't describe what's happening inside, but maybe you are able to describe the order and well, that's my explanation. Okay. So but now, upon further loading, the Plasticzone grows or extends, and in the end, it covers the complete net section. So everything in the net section is fully plastic. And when you have a fully plastic net section, then the net section stress sigma subscript n is equal to Rp 0.2. Okay? Everywhere. Forgetting about harmony. It's more ideally the plastic idea of the plastic materials, but harmony wouldn't exert a big effect. Now then, so here we have the Rp 0.2. Then we can define a, some people call it plastic limit load, I call it a yield load because it's not the real plastic limit load. And here we have the, what I call the yield load. As the whole thing yields, the whole net section, the yield load or yield force, F sub I or yield is Rp 0.2 times the net section here. The net section is 2 times W minus A, of course, right? Times the thickness of the thing. Times capital B, and B, oops, here, is the thickness. This is, these are standardized symbols. Capital B for thickness, lowercase a for crack size, capital W for width, and so on and so forth. So this is a yield load, another important formula. For other cases, bending and so forth, you can easily derive the other yield loads. But this has consequences, as you will see in a moment. Now, going back to such a specimen, and imagine we can fabricate in our workshop, we can fabricate such a specimen. We have a piece of sheet metal, and it's easy to fabricate this. We make a saw cut either with a hand saw or a milling machine, and we apply a fatigue load and create a crack of a specific size. Then we pull the thing to fracture. Okay. Fracture test. A supposed to be to stay constant for the moment. It's not entirely true, but to keep the problem simple, this is my assumption. But the applied stress is equal to a critical stress sigma sub c, and with this, we calculate the critical stress intensity factor equal to sigma C times square root of pi A times the Y function. And you may imagine, he's having a hard time, he wants to tape me all the time, and when I walk around, it doesn't work. But I can't sit there on my chair. I think it's whenever you have done any kind of material test, you can imagine that whenever I test different materials, that I get different results of the critical stress intensity factor. Like when I do a normal standard tensile test, I obtain different values for the critical stress, tensile strength, R sub m. The same holds for fracture mechanics. We have a fracture mechanics property, and which can be described by a critical, under the inelastic conditions, by a critical stress intensity factor. But the other interesting thing is that we really don't know anything about the local stresses. You know, at first glance you may wish to calculate the local stresses in the plastic zone where fracture occurs, no, which is possible, but we don't need it. Because we have such a global parameter which describes the global, namely the fracture behavior of this plate, but the price we have to pay is that we don't know what's happening inside, and we don't need to know. Okay. So this is an interesting result that we, by a simple kind of experiment, then we can determine the critical stress intensity factor, which we call fracture toughness. Okay, this is what we call fracture toughness in terms of the linear elastic stress intensity factor. Now, this is the simplest test specimen because it has simple stress conditions, loading conditions. Once again, such a plane here, pull here, force F, and here is crack size 2A. And, down here, the specimen is clamped, is fixed, and in addition to the applied force, we usually measure characteristic displacement, the formation of the specimen. It is either the elongation here, or more suitably, if this is the deformed crack, the crack deforms, it opens up, of course. What used to be closed under unload condition opens up. And this can be measured. And for this displacement here, this is the CMOD, the crack mouth opening displacement, or the symbol is usually a little V. So please distinguish between the acronym and the symbol. It is frequently confused. The symbol is V, the mathematical symbol, and the acronym to say time and space, CMOD, because when I say CMOD takes maybe a tenth of a second less as compared to, I would say, crack mouth opening displacement. Unfortunately, acronyms are flooding the world in particular in computer technology. Okay, now we do an experiment, and our test record is usually the following. We plot the applied force as a function of F, the deformation, just like the tensile test, sigma as a function of strain. I'm hesitating a bit because basically it's wrong, because we apply a deformation. We pull the machine apart. We apply a deformation and the reaction, we measure the reaction, which is in like force, you know. But our thinking is usually just the other way around. You know? Okay. Now, oops. We will, at the beginning, we see a linear relationship, although at a very small scale, we have already plastic deformation as the crack tips, but as long as the area here of the volume is small enough, we can't sense it with this macroscopic measurement. But then comes a point where this is being sensed because the volume increases, or here in the plane a bit increases, and this causes an increasing non-linearity of the diagram. Increasing non-linearity, so like in a usual tensile test, and the behavior is then kind of this, the roundhouse curve. It goes down to zero if you have a stiff testing machine. Why does it go down to zero? Number one, the crack grows or extends, which you don't measure at this moment. So the cross-section shrinks, and the thickness reduces by plastic deformation, and so on and so forth. So here is maybe the yield force F sub Y, where this condition is met. F sub Y, and due to hardening, the hardening behavior of the material, it can go beyond the yield load because the material hardens. And so this is here hardening. Okay. Now we know by experience. Faces, just a few minutes. By experience, lots of tests and element analysis and so on and so forth, we have learned that linear elastic fracture mechanics can be used without making big errors up to 15% of the yield load, 0.5 Fy. So up to here, you can use the linear elastic stress measurement. And beyond that, I'm not going here into the details, beyond that we have to add 1/2 of the plastic zone size to the crack size, and it's still okay. And this should suffice here. And now, before we go to lunch, I'd like to show you a very interesting diagram. It's not from me, it is from somebody else, but almost nobody knows it. And I find it very interesting, so that's why I'm bringing it in all my courses. Stress intensity factor for a given material. Okay. Here. But this equation can be used in the reverse direction. You may have a specimen or component or whatever with a given crack size and a given width, and you can ask what is the magnitude of the critical space? How high can I load this component or specimen? So the critical stress, sigma c, is kc over square root 2 pi a and the y function, which once again is a dimensionless function, it's just figures. Now the diagram. I know many people have difficulties understanding the diagram at first glance because it lives on normalization. Now I'm plotting here on the x-axis, I have a over w, so the normalized crack size between 0 and 1. And here on the ordinate, I plot the applied stress sigma and also the net section stress happening here in the net section. What I also plot is a line where the net section stress equals the yield strength of the material up in 0.2. And this is in this diagram for a tensile loaded plate, a linear line. Here is RP 0.2, and this is a linear relationship where sigma n equals RP 0.2. I should reduce this anymore here. Okay. So here the yield load is reached, or here. And above here, the elastic fracture mechanics are definitely not applicable. Now imagine a given, a fixed size, a fixed W value, and a variable crack size, and we calculate the critical stress as a function of crack size, and we end up with a hyperbola. It's not exactly a hyperbola because this function here pulls it down to zero at this point here, but this is not so important. For a given W, now let's take a wider panel, much wider panel, which for the same A over W has also a greater crack size. Okay. And greater crack size means a smaller applied stress. So the hyperbola for a wider test space is here. And so on and so forth. And when we shrink the size, we go to a much narrower test space. Of course, the formally calculated using this formula. Yeah, so this is W as a parameter. Now, what do we learn from this diagram? You may have heard that materials are brittle, fade in a brittle manner, or ductile means deformable, a lot of energy. Here we have a given material, and we have circumstances where the same material fails in a brittle manner, because when we go with the high W, with a low curve, We have a very small plastic deformation, so the global deformation is linear lattice. Whereas when we go to smaller crack sizes, we are approaching full plasticity. Same material can behave in a fully plastic and in a brittle manner. Depending on size parameters. And these size parameters are crack length and width of the component. Of course, we have materials with a higher toughness or lower toughness. If I would take aging steel or monzitic steel, I would be much lower here. The whole thing would behave in a very brittle manner, of course. But what I want to show here that this is typical of age-hardened medium alloys. So all the experiments we have done on these alloys, I've done similar experiments too. And so this is a lesson that we can have to be careful. And in the earlier days of fracture mechanics, some 30 years ago or so, I attended a lecture by somebody from the German TÜV, which is the certifying authority. So every 2 or 3 years you have to show up with your car at the TÜV, and they do the inspections, everything safe, and they are also responsible for pressure vessels and nuclear stuff and so on and so forth. And that guy made a presentation, and he said, we have done pressure vessel tests, and in all these tests, we had ductile failure, so the things were safe, so to speak, because brittle fracture would have been bad. But all these vessels failed under its ductile behavior. And he said, I put myself into a position that I don't know anything about elastic-plastic fracture mechanics, which was later learned. Then did a linear elastic estimate. And linear elastic means brittle. I hope you get the point. He used this equation and did a prediction which was far higher than the experimental fracture learners. He said, this is the proof that fracture mechanics doesn't work. Even the brittle and the wrong thinking, wrong conclusion was low stress estimate. Safe side. What's wrong? This conclusion was wrong. You can show it easily on this diagram. You can't do a linear elastic analysis for a case that behaves in a fully plastic manner because you're awfully non-conservative by figures, by even figures, you know, 2, 3, 4 factors. If you're not careful enough, you always have to search for the yield load. Sometimes it's a simple case, but when you have a complex structure, maybe an offshore platform or whatever it is, what I teach my or tell my students is before you apply fracture mechanics, please determine the yield load. And then do your analysis. Then you know where you are. Once again, when you have a complex thing, you don't know whether it would fail in a more brittle manner or a more plastic, deformable manner. With these wise words, I think we can go into our lunch break. And I think the locals know where the cafeteria is. We have a guide who knows where we can go. Yeah? Okay. Is it now okay? And now, or do you need a knife? Okay, now, thank you.